In mid-March, I put out a community post asking, what confuses you or you just don't know about in Warframe at the moment? It turns out, there's quite a few people confused about various things, which makes sense, it's Warframe. So, I've picked out a few of these questions or confusions to answer for you today, so everyone can be a little bit less lost. I'm the Engineer, let's solve a practical problem. Also, in case you weren't already aware, this isn't the only way you can get your questions answered. You can join me on my Twitch streams at twitch.tv/thekengineer for Warframe every Wednesday and Sunday. To learn more, join the games, or just sit back and enjoy the vibes. Now, in this community post, a number of people mentioned Eidolons, talking around strategy, amp choices, that sort of thing. But one post stuck out from Sila Hamwi, asking, why operator amps deal so little damage against Eidolons in comparison to what the amp UI says? That's a good question, with a relatively simple answer. But strangely enough, it's not covered correctly on the wiki. Every player should already be aware of enemies which reduce incoming damage, like the armor on most Grineer. Armor reduces the damage done to health, so a shot that supposedly deals 1000 damage would show a much smaller number on the hit. However, armor doesn't apply to shields. Instead, what's happening with the Eidolons is their shields have an innate damage reduction applied to all incoming amp damage. The damage you actually deal is governed by this equation. The base damage is multiplied by 0.04, then plus 108 divided by the fire rate. As far as damage reduction equations go, this is both simple and weird at the same time. Effectively, your damage is reduced 25 times over, but then an extra 108 DPS is just added on top. Weirder still, this isn't the whole story. If you land a critical hit on an Eidolon, your damage is multiplied by the crit as you would expect, but then it's also doubled before going through the rest of the equation. This means you end up with base damage, multiplied by the crit multiplier, multiplied by 2, and then it's multiplied by 0.04 plus 108 over the fire rate. That is how much damage your critical hits will actually deal to the Eidolon shields. Because of this, a weapon which can land critical hits more regularly will just deal more damage. There are some other smaller calculations going on, like the Schwark Prism's multi-hits dealing less damage on those following hits, or radial attacks having a fall-off. But it's this damage reduction formula on the Eidolon which has the biggest impact on why your amp seems to be just roughly 25 times worse against the shields. I'm not sure why DE didn't just give Eidolons 25 times more shields, and I really don't know what's going on with that 108 divided by fire rate term just thrown in there. But this is what some Reddit users found a few years ago, and it's still accurate today. Following on from the topic of Eidolons, we've got Nakik666, confused on arcane farming. Specifically, they're not sure why Orphix haven't become the meta for getting arcanes. Orphix is a game mode found exclusively in Corpus Railjack. Your job is to first slog through some side objectives to unlock the actual mission, then board a Corpus ship being assaulted by sentients. Corpus, being the geniuses they are, will continuously attack you whilst you try to deal with the sentient problem. This originally features an event with slightly different timings, but now the game mode is simply one Orphix spawned per minute, and either you deal with them in a timely fashion, or you get overwhelmed. You can't do this mission any faster because of the spawn rate, and it's unfeasible to do the mission slower, as otherwise the end condition of 100% sentient control will trigger. You are basically hardlocked to one Orphix per minute, plus loading, pre-objective, and travel time. In terms of rewards, you can get arcanes every 12 Orphix, and some other unimportant rewards like a little bit of endo every 3rd Orphix that isn't an arcane drop. At 1 Orphix per minute, that's 12 minutes of Orphix for 1 arcane, not counting the extra time on the ends. The mission scales up in difficulty at a solid rate, and it is hard capped at 36 Orphix, after which you have to extract. Because of this, you can manage 4 arcane drops in an hour, but definitely not 5. Compare this then to Eidolon hunting. Sure, you can't do it all the time, only during nighttime on Earth. However, experienced Eidolon hunters are not limited to a single run in a night on Earth. They can achieve a full 3 Eidolon captures, a tri-cap, multiple times over. Experienced squads can handle 3 tri-caps with ease, and the most proficient can achieve 5 or 6 tri-caps in the night. So on the one hand, there's the option of spending around 40 to 45 minutes getting 3 arcanes, and that's assuming you manage to kill all 36 Orphix. On the other hand, an experienced squad is getting between 9 and 18 arcanes in a 50 minute night. Then there's the matter of drop rates. A tri-cap will access 3 different drop tables for arcanes, with an average of 0.76 common arcanes, 1.39 uncommons, 0.72 rares, and 0.15 legendaries. On the other hand, the best Orphix mission for drops, the Veil Proxima mission Erato, will reward an average of 2.20 uncommons, 0.68 rares, and 0.13 legendaries. A single full Orphix run has a less valuable payout than a single tri-cap, and yet it takes substantially longer. There are other rewards to consider too. Orphix missions will also give you Endo, and then some intrinsics and a smattering of Axie relics. Eidolon hunts, on the other hand, provide sentient cores, enabling progress of the Quill Syndicate, and Eidolon shards, giving substantial amounts of focus for the operator focus trees. These focus trees are changing soon, so watch that space, but up to today, this has been a big point in favour of Eidolons. And to top it all off, you need to consider the gear difference. To defeat Eidolons, you just need a suitable Warframe, like even a starter frame like Vault, a weapon capable of dealing lots of high crit radiation damage, and then a good amp. Pretty much everything else beyond that is just optimization. But for Orphix, you must have a suitable Railjack just to get through the pre-mission objectives, and then you need a suitable Necromech built to handle 36 Orphix of ever-increasing level. Far more people can put their hands onto a high crit radiation weapon than they can an Orphix-ready Necromech. So that's why Orphix isn't the meta. It's slower, arguably harder, and yet it has worse primary and secondary rewards. The only upside is that you can do Orphix at any time, while Eidolon hunts only have 1/3 uptime. By all means, go do some Orphix in the downtime, but remember that the rate is going to be much slower. Okay, it's time to move away from talking about Eidolons and Arcanes, and look at a more simple question asked by Uncreative Name. How does Shattering Impact work? Shattering Impact states that impact damage reduces enemy armor by 6. Let's expand on what this actually means. For the impact damage, it means quite literally any amount of impact damage. If the hit includes impact, the mod is triggered. Not impact procs, just impact damage. But how about this reducing enemy armor by 6? How much armor do enemies have? Well, we all know that as enemies level up, they get stronger, and it's no secret that this includes the armor value of armored enemies. However, Shattering Impact doesn't give 2 hoots about enemy level. All it cares about is the base value of the armor before levels are applied. Each proc of Shattering Impact will reduce the base armor by 6 permanently, therefore reducing the true armor value often by quite a bit more than that. Not only does this make the armor reduction significantly more powerful than it may at first seem, it also means that you'll require exactly the same number of hits to remove all the armor from an enemy at level 20 as you would at level 120. Not even the armor modifier from Steel Path changes this. By looking at the Codex, or the Wiki if you prefer, we can see how much base armor a unit has. For example, a Drekkar Elite Lancer has 200 base armor. Removing 6 at a time, it would take 34 hits to fully remove their armor, and that's exactly what we see. A couple weapons, specifically the Sarpa and the Vastalok, are capable of firing multiple pellets from a single melee attack, allowing them to apply Shattering Impact many times over very quickly. In fact, just 4 shots from the Vastalok will remove all of the armor from this Drekkar Elite Lancer. The same happens even on enemies with both armor and shields, stripping their armor before you've even breached the shields, as seen on this Ambulus here. Now, as for comboing this with Corrosive, it still takes the same number of hits to fully remove the armor. This is because while Shattering Impact affects the base armor, Corrosive is a debuff to what armor remains, rather than a subtraction. Because of this, you're usually far better off just not using Corrosive when you've got Shattering Impact. For our next question, Luna asks, how do people get all those mastery points, Lameo? Well, the simple answer is by ranking up weapons, frames, and other bits and pieces around the game. In fact, quite a lot of stuff contributes to your mastery points, and therefore overall mastery rank. The vast, vast majority of all mastery points will come from Warframes and weapons in the primary, secondary, and melee slots. However, a sizable chunk can be obtained elsewhere. If you were to level every single Warframe in the game, not including Excalibur Prime, you would achieve 498,000 mastery points, which, on its own, would be enough to get you to MR14. If you leveled and maxed everything available in the game normally, without including vaulted items, event items, that sort of stuff, you could get all the way to MR29 without having to trade with a single player. To achieve MR30, however, would require either trading, waiting for vault rotations, or obtaining limited time rewards like the Dex weaponry given out during Warframe anniversaries. Now, if you are happy to trade with players, it is possible to reach MR30 with no event items, no daily tributes, no Founders Pack, no K-Drives, no Amps, Archmalets, Necromex, Hounds, Mowers, Predacites, or Kubros. The flip side being, skipping all of these would require you to actually max everything else. That includes Steel Path, Kuva Weapons, Intrinsics, and so on. So in a nutshell, Mastery is there to be had in a number of different ways. But if you want enough Mastery points to actually reach MR30, you're either going to need enough Patience to wait for Vault and Barrow rotations, or enough Platinum to trade for items instead. Let's wrap up with one more question then, this time from Tethys, asking, how is affinity or rep from Codex or Simaris scans calculated? Well, this is a little bit of an odd one. Firstly, the affinity from Codex scans is not equal to the standing game from Synthesis scans. In fact, the two figures are barely related at all. The affinity gain from a Codex scan is approximately equal to 1/3 of the affinity you would gain for killing the enemy, or equal to the affinity for a normal kill if you do it while the enemy is unalerted, showing up as a stealth scan. Now, you can only scan an enemy a limited number of times with a Codex scanner, and that is until their Codex entry is complete. Because of this, once you're outside of the early game, this won't be coming up too much for you. The affinity you can earn is assigned on a per enemy basis, and it's modified by level, exactly like the affinity from killing these leveled enemies. Now, as for Synthesis scans, granting Samaris reputation, they follow an entirely different pattern. Once again, all enemies have a base value, but this value is much less random, around 50-ish for almost every enemy I checked. This value is then increased by 0.6 per level, and the final result is rounded down. So a level 1 enemy will usually give you around 50 Samaris standing, some dropping to 48, some maybe as high as 55, while a level 101 enemy will give 60 standing more, around 110 for most cases. If you perform a stealth scan, the result is not quite tripled. As far as I can tell, the base value is added to 0.6 per level bonus as before, but then it's multiplied by 1.5, rounded down, and then doubled. This is a bit convoluted, but it's about the only thing I can figure to fit, given that every single stealth scan performed with the Synthesis scanner always gives an even result, even though it seems to be tripling a sometimes odd number. So, Codex scan affinity is based on the enemy you are scanning, giving more affinity for enemies, which give more affinity when they're killed, while Samaris standing from Synthesis scans are close to being the same regardless of enemy, mostly varying due to level. And if you are scanning an unalerted enemy, it'll give you roughly triple in some weird not quite triple fashion. Because, you know, nothing's going to be simple in Warframe. As ever, Warframe is a very big, incredibly confusing game, with almost every answer just raising two more questions. In any case, I hope you've enjoyed the video and perhaps learned something new. If you have, remember to give it a like and subscribe to catch more as it goes live. That's all from me for now though, so as always, scan enemies, strip armor, and fight well, Tenno.